So the topic of the next few lectures is filter design, okay? And so far in this class, we've drawn a bunch of diagrams that look something like this, where I have, you know, x of n goes into some filter that has a transfer function or a frequency response h, and I get this guy out. And just refresher that, you know, we know that in the time domain, what I'm doing is I'm convolving the input with some impulse response. In the frequency domain, I am multiplying the two, you know, frequency domain versions together. And just a quick note that I can represent this complex function of omega by a magnitude and a phase, right? So here's the magnitude and here's the phase. The magnitude is just the product of these two magnitudes. And the phase is just the sum of these two magnitudes. And so when you guys did, for example, stuff like Bode plots, you would, you know, take advantage of this property, right? That the magnitudes multiply and the phases add. Okay. And so many times up to this point, we've kind of talked about saying, okay, let's suppose that H is some low-pass filter. Okay, that kind of is a standard thing now. For example, in the last lecture, we were talking about how you need these low-pass filters to do sampling rate changes, right? There's one filter to get rid of possible aliasing, and there's another filter to do the reconstruction of filling in between the samples. And so for that, a lot of times we'll draw a, you know, kind of idealized filter in the frequency domain that looks something like this. We want to exactly pass the frequencies between minus omega c and plus omega c and throw out all the other frequencies. Right? And so here, this is kind of like an ideal filter. This is what we would want. One for omega less than this cutoff and zero otherwise. And, you know, we started out talking about what is the time domain version of this. Well, it's a pulse in the frequency domain, so it should be a sync in the time domain, right? So I know that my ideal time domain low-pass filter is something like this sync function that involves the cutoff frequency. So there are some problems with this, though, right? A main problem is that this sync function goes on forever, right? So if I was to kind of plot it, you know, there would be values that go out all the way to infinity. Sorry for my crappy picture, but something like this, right? So problem one is, you know, infinite length impulse response. And number two is it's not causal, right? There's a lot of stuff going on the left-hand side of the impulse response that means that I'm looking into the future to get my values I need to filter, okay? So what can we do to mitigate this? So kind of what I want to do today is, first of all, I want to find impulse responses that are finite length, right? Those are called FIR filters. And second of all, I want to have filters that are causal, okay, which means I don't have to look into the future to get my values. So let's first start by thinking about a filter that is just a pure delay. So one thing I'm going to make a comment on is that if we look back at this guy, we can see that here there's no absolute value bars on this way, or here. All I'm saying is that literally the frequencies in the middle are passed through entirely, and the frequencies outside are thrown away, right? That means that the magnitude here is either one or zero, and there's no phase shift in this filter, right? Meaning that the phases of the input signal are not altered at all, okay? So let's just talk about what happens when I have an ideal delay. Right, an ideal delay, let's think about this like this. This just is saying that I take what I had and I shift it by some number of integer units.
Okay.
So I can compute the Fourier transform of that really easily. That's just e to the minus j omega nd, where this nd is the constant delay. And so in this case, again, this is just e to the j something, so this has just got a magnitude of 1. And the angle of this is just minus omega nd, right? Because I know that h of omega is the magnitude e to the j, the angle. Okay. And so one thing to note here is that in this case, the change in phase, the shift in phase, is a linear function of omega, right? So here, the phase shift is a linear function of omega. Okay. And so that's a good thing. So if we interpret this for a second, what this means is that if I were to consider a function, a filter that has linear phase, what happens to it is that I'm basically delaying the output by some number of units, right? And so that doesn't really count as distortion, right? So kind of what it means is, yes, I'm changing the phases of all the cosines and sines and signal, but I'm changing them all by the same energy delay. So the ultimate effect is that those cosines and sines are not kind of changing their relative positions with respect to each other. They're all just getting moved down by an integer number of units, okay? So it would be bad if each one of these guys was getting moved by a slightly different amount, and so that when I add them up together, it would be kind of like a garbled version of the signal. Instead, I'm kind of moving each of these guys at the same number of units, okay? So basically, the output sequence is just the input shifted in time. So we don't consider this distortion. So as you're going to see, in many cases, we cannot achieve exactly zero phase, meaning that the output occurs at exactly the same time as the input. Instead, what we are willing to tolerate is linear phase, which means that the output is just delayed by a few units from the input. Okay. So that's kind of the idea behind the desirability of linear phase filters. So the kind of upshot is we desire filters with linear phase. Okay, so for example, if I was to modify my original low-pass filter with linear phase, it would look like this instead. That would be like saying, here's my modified low-pass filter. If I multiply the magnitude with the linear phase, what I would have is something like this. This would be what happens inside the passband, and this would be what happens inside the stopband. Right, so here, this satisfies that the magnitude is equal to 1, or 0, and the angle is equal to minus omega d, which is linear. And so what would the corresponding time domain impulse response be? Well, that would be just like taking the old impulse response I had and shifting it by n sub d units. So I would have this as my time domain impulse response instead of being centered at 0. And so if I was to kind of look at my picture, that would be like saying, okay, instead of having this be the zero element, I could shift my zero element over so that the peak of the sync function was nd units away, right? And so you can imagine a strategy where you'd say, okay, well, you know, I could kind of wait until these values are really small on the left-hand side, and there I could put my delay, and then, you know, I'd have lots of stuff on the right-hand side. You know, that's a viable strategy, but one of the problems is that still, this thing has a response that still kind of trickles on forever. Really what I want to do is I want to find a nice finite impulse response, and that's going to be the subject of what we talk about today. Okay. And just to make some comments, so sometimes you will see, you know, a measure called the group delay, which is just a thing that you'll see if you use like some of MATLAB's tools. The group delay is defined as the basically the derivative of the angle. And I'm just going to make a quick note here. So sometimes, again, you'll see a couple of different things. And I want to make sure that, let me draw this first, actually. So normally what we have is the, we have the magnitude of h, which, since it's always positive, for example, may look something like this. And then we have the angle of h. And if you look in MATLAB when you compute the angle, what you'll see is probably something that looks kind of like this, where there are a bunch of like jaggedy things like this. And the jaggedy parts come from the fact that when this thing flips from, you know, hits the zero and bounces back up, there's usually a sharp discontinuity in what MATLAB will tell you as the angle, right? And there's also issues where the angle kind of wraps around so that it's always between 0 and 2 pi. And so you basically end up with some of these discontinuities that are pi high and some discontinuities that are 2 pi high. Neither of these is really that desirable to work with from a kind of analysis point of view because of these, you know, discontinuities. Or not discontinuities, but these, you know, sharp angles, right? The derivative is not continuous. So oftentimes what we will do is talk about the amplitude response instead of the magnitude response. So here this is the magnitude response. Instead there's something called the amplitude response. And that's what you get when you kind of naturally let the signal, you know, dip down below its zero axis like this, right? So that's kind of like what I would get if I let this guy go here. This guy is much nicer to work with because it's continuous and it's nice and smooth, right? So I can do things like take derivatives and think of it as the sum of a bunch of cosines and so on. And the corresponding version of the phase is basically taking this jaggedy thing and letting it unwrap so that it's a nice smooth function, right? So if I was to kind of compensate for these jumps in the function, I could make, hopefully, a nice continuous function of angle as a function of omega, right? And so this you sometimes see called phase unwrapping. So here, I would call this the, you know, this I call phase unwrapping. And the nice thing is that, you know, this amplitude response is just, you know, plus or minus the magnitude response. But the nice thing is it's continuous and differentiable. Okay. So basically what I can do is I can think about, just going back to phase for a second, you know, one measure of how good is the phase is kind of like saying how close is this unwrapped function to being a linear function, right? And so here, this is like saying if I were to take the derivative of this, I would just get a constant, right? And so basically I can take a look at the group delay and say if the group delay is close to constant, then I'm close to linear phase. If it's not, then I'm probably not a linear phase function. Okay. And so in the next part of the talk, we're going to kind of concentrate on the nice stuff on this side instead of the jaggedy stuff on that side. Okay, we're going to kind of think about how do I design the amplitude response of a certain filter to do what I want. Okay, so let me stop and ask if there are any questions so far about kind of terminology. Yeah?
How do you get amplitude responses? Like, is that like the real part?
It's not the real part. Well, it is. So here, this is kind of like the absolute value of the frequency response, right? This guy, right? And then this guy, you can kind of tell like when you're positive and you hit zero and you kind of bounce back up, then that probably means that you're flipping the sign underneath, right? So we're going to show you in just a second, if I have a filter that has got real values, I can explicitly write this A of omega in terms of the filter taps, right? And that will nicely oscillate above and below the axis, right? So in the kind of thing we're going to talk about next, there's like an explicit formula for the amplitude response given the filter coefficients, right? So you don't have to really figure out what it is. You'll be able to construct it directly with this formula. So yeah, you'll see that in just a couple slides. Okay. Other questions? Okay, so the question is, how do we design filters, right? So kind of at the very big picture, we have a process, right? And this is where, you know, there's a little bit more kind of engineering involved, right? So really what I want to do is I start with some sort of a kind of desired frequency response. And I'm going to try and get as close as possible to that frequency response subject to the constraints that I have to work with in the real world, right? So kind of the first step is choose my desired frequency response. The next step is choose an allowable class of filters. And for example, I might say, okay, I need to get as close as possible to this response with a length n FIR, finite impulse response filter. Okay. So that means I'm only going to give you capital N values, non-zero values, the impulse response, and you have to get as close as possible to this picture. Okay. The third thing is kind of defining what do we mean as close as possible, right? So we have to choose a kind of a measure of quality, you know, by which I mean, you know, this is really slangy, but something like how close is one response to another? I need to be able to compare directly, quantitatively, here's frequency response one, here's frequency response two, what is the distance between them, right? And we're going to talk about several different measures of what that distance could be, okay? And four is I need to have some sort of a method or an algorithm that cranks out those values. Right? So I need to, you know, once I tell you this is what defines an optimal filter, that doesn't necessarily imply that I know how to actually find the best n numbers. I have to find a way to crank through and find those numbers. And then kind of after that, which I'm not going to really talk about, is, you know, choose kind of the best realization of the filter. And kind of what I mean there is, if you think about last time, we talked about different ways of implementing the same filter, right? We had the original, you know, H of Z, and then we had a polyphase version of that where we split into a bunch of little parts and applied the filter kind of with little chunks of the original impulse response. And then we had a version where we kind of, instead of delaying the signal by Z and Z squared and Z cubed, I would have like a chain set of delays where I put like one delay on the left-hand bar, right? So you can see back in your notes, we kind of talked about three different ways of making the same output. And each of those ways has slightly different properties, for example, for performance in the presence of noise. We don't want noise in the input to propagate to noise in the output. And so there's a lot of work on finding out the best way to arrange the filter taps in a certain structure to be able to be good, for example, for a circuit, okay? And so I'm not going to talk about this too much, but this is another important issue in signal processing. Okay, and so today I'm going to restrict myself to the kinds of filters that we like. So, you know, we want real filters that are causal and digital. And in general, we only care in this class about filters that have the form of the transfer functions that you guys are used to seeing, right? So something like this. because we know in this world we can talk about poles and zeros and so on. We can talk about Z transforms. And so this is kind of like the easiest kind of set of filters to work with. And we get these names, right? So if, you know, all these AIs, if the denominator coefficients are equal to zero, we have what's called an FIR filter, which stands for finite impulse response. Otherwise, you can show that we have an IIR filter, which stands for infinite impulse response. Right, so we've already encountered these kinds of filters already in our other exercises, right? Because if I can give you just a list of numbers, that's FIR. And if I give you a function of n, like, you know, 1/2 to the n power u of n, that's infinite impulse response, right? So these should already be pretty much familiar. And so what I need to do is say, okay, I need to find, you know, some way to kind of minimize over the set of A's and B's some sort of a norm or distance function of the error, which I could write as something like saying, okay, I take the desired transfer function and I look at the difference between that and the transfer function that I have. And so what we're going to talk about today are different choices of how this norm or how this distance function might work. Okay? Okay. Because, I mean, we want to make this problem tractable in a way that I can actually solve it. So, as I started out talking about, I'm going to not only say that my filters are going to be real and causal, but I'm going to restrict my attention to linear phase filters, right? Because linear phase is good. We'll restrict our attention. Is Janet trapped out there? No. So she was lurking out there. She's trying to be sneaky. All right, we'll restrict our attention to linear phase filters. Now that door's open. Okay, so now I gotta open this because I gotta close the door. Okay. So remember, we want linear phase filters. And so let's think about what that means. So let's consider some filter that is length n, FIR filter, and assume it has linear phase. And actually, I'm going to be even a little bit more general than I was earlier and say that, you know, my phase, and here, this theta of omega is going to be like, I should have put it over here. So here, I'm kind of assuming that this nicely continuous guy I'm going to call theta of omega. So let's assume that that is a nice straight line, and I'm going to allow myself the freedom to move this line around so that maybe it doesn't necessarily go through zero. So let's say that it looks like some constant plus some other constant omega, right? That's like a generalization of linear phase. And so let's see what that implies for the corresponding frequency response. Okay, so I'm just going to plug and chug. So here's my assumption, and now I'm going to compute what is my frequency response? Well, I've got n non-zero entries, e to the minus j omega n. And now what I'm going to do is I'm going to make a little bit of a substitution. So here, what I'm going to do is I'm going to try and make this sum a little bit different. I'm going to take a factor of, let's let m equal n minus 1 over 2. Okay, so this is just basically like half the length of the filter, more or less. I'm going to take out a e to the j omega m. And that means I have to add it back in inside the sum. So that means I have this guy. And so I'm going to just kind of put that together here. I guess here I'm going to have it e to the plus j omega m minus m, like this. And now I'm going to multiply out this guy in terms of cosines and sines. So I'm going to be a little bit sneaky and say, okay, first let me write this down, and then I'll explain why it's true. So what I'm doing is I'm writing this out in such a way that collects cosines and sines together, right? So let's just think about the first part, right? So for example, if I have the h of 0 term, right, the h of 0 term is multiplying e to the j omega m. And the h of n term, I'm sorry, the h of capital, yeah, the h of n term, or n minus 1 term, is multiplying e to the j omega m minus n minus 1. Sorry for my F. Like this a little bigger. E to the j omega m minus n minus 1. And I kind of define this m in such a way that this thing is equal to e to the j omega m, right? Because this here is half of this. So this is actually like this. So what I have is an h of 0 that multiplies e to the j omega m, and h of n minus 1 that multiplies e to the minus j omega m, and that's where these cosines and sines come from, right? So the idea is I'm just kind of taking out, you know, half of the guys to be able to make the impulse responses at either end of the impulse response add up with the same cosine. And so the nice thing about this is that here I've kind of isolated one part that just kind of depends on cosines and sines, and the other part that looks like the linear phase I'm going to want to get. Okay. So kind of what I want to do is I want to make this general formula, you know, look like. So when can this be put in the form h omega looks like some real amplitude e to the j some linear phase. And so what I do is I kind of compare the terms, right? So one thing that I could do is I could say, well, I would have a real amplitude if I could get rid of all these sine terms, right? That way, the inside of this big parenthesis would just be the sum of a bunch of real cosines, and the outside would just be this linear phase, right? So for example, I could say, you know, if h of n equals h of n minus 1, then all of the sine terms drop away, and I can rewrite that whole chunk as saying, you know, h of omega equals e to the minus j omega m times, you know, h0 plus h n minus 1 cosine omega m plus h1 plus hn minus 2 cosine omega m minus 1, and so on. So that would be nice, right? Because that would mean that I could fundamentally write exactly like this. So my a of omega becomes this sum. I would have capital M terms inside the sum, and then each of these guys would be equal, which would mean that I would just be able to look at just half of the impulse response. So I'm going to write here and say, if n is odd. So if n is odd, what happens is that I have basically a dc term that's like cosine of zero, and then I have capital M cosines that add up, and since these guys are made by construction to be equal, I get 2 times kind of like the left half of the impulse response. And so what that means is that my h of n has this kind of special structure, right? So all I'm saying, to make this a little bit easier, is that all this means is that h of n is symmetric around its middle element. Right? So for example, if I had n equals 5, that would be my m would be equal to n minus 1 over 2, which would be equal to 2. And I would have something that looks like this. You know, I'd have something that is symmetric around the 2 value. And so kind of what I've shown is that any symmetric filter, so if I have an odd length filter and it's symmetric around the middle, that means that guy will automatically have linear phase, and the linear phase of that will be e to the minus j omega m, right? And so now what I've done is I've said, okay, my linear phase requirement puts this special constraint on the shape of my filter. It has to be symmetric around the middle, okay? And, you know, it's also true that, you know, if n is even, then instead I get something that looks like, yeah, there's a slightly different formula for the amplitude. What that means in that case is that I don't have this extra cosine in the middle that's the odd one out, and so my amplitude looks like something like this. There's no extra h of m over here. And the nice thing is that that corresponds to a filter that is, again, symmetric, but there is no kind of middle element to flip around. It's just, you know, kind of symmetric around this halfway point. So in either case, depending on whether n is odd or even, a symmetric filter will do the job of giving me linear phase. Okay. Okay, so we're going to mostly talk in this class today about this special case where n is odd and it's nicely symmetric around this middle element, right? That's really what we care about in this class right now. But I will say in general that there are kind of, it turns out, 4 types of filters that give me possible linear phase, okay? And these are called type 1 through type 4 filters. And so type 1 basically is n is odd, and this is also n is odd, and this n is even, and this n is even. And in this case, what I have is a symmetric impulse response around the middle element. Same thing here. It also turns out to give me a linear phase if I have an anti-symmetric response, so something like this. And the kind of analog is something like this. And I use these types of filters depending on what kind of frequency response I want. And so it turns out that the amplitude response in each of these cases can be drawn as follows. So a type 1 filter gives me an amplitude response that looks something like this. I'm going to actually kind of mark off these axes here before I start drawing them. Whoops, I don't know why I did this. So you can show, basically here, just as I did for these guys, you can show that the amplitude that you get is the sum of a bunch of cosines, okay? And in general, what that looks like is that for a type 1 filter, that amplitude response looks something like this. Something that basically has kind of like a low pass, you know, look to it. Type 2 filters have a similar thing, but it looks a little bit different because of this guy here. So what the type 2 filter looks like is like this in terms of amplitude. A type 3 filter looks like this. I'm just going to draw these and I'm going to talk about them for a second. And a type 4 filter looks like this. So the eagle-eyed among you are going to say, well, wait a second, I thought that these DTFTs were always 2 pi periodic, right? What is up with these guys here that are clearly not? Well, the reason is that if I was to take the magnitude of that, I would get a 2 pi periodic response, right? It's just that when I allow the amplitude response to dip below the axis, I may have something that's not, you know, so these guys are 4 pi periodic, this guy and this guy, but if I was to take the absolute value, I would get the 2 pi periodicity that I know must exist. And so the idea is that what I do is I choose the right filter type depending on whether I want to design a low pass or a high pass filter, for example. So here, you know, this is even around zero and even around 2 pi. This is a great choice if I want to design low pass filters, right? But if I wanted to design a high pass filter, it turns out that, you know, this is not a good choice because it's inevitably, you know, well, actually, put it this way. This would be a bad choice here, a type 4 filter for a low-pass filter, because it's inevitably got to be 0 in the middle, right? So this is a bad choice for low-pass, but a good choice for a high-pass filter. And so, you know, this is good for high-pass. You know, this would also probably be good for high-pass, although I have to... This is more like a good band-pass filter, actually, because I'm inevitably going to be 0 every multiple of pi. So this could be like a good bandpass filter. You know, this would also be probably a good low-pass filter. So the idea is that you can't just kind of assume that you can throw in, you know, say, okay, well, I want a filter that looks like this, give me a low-pass filter. There are some constraints to what kinds of amplitude responses you can get given the shapes of the things. So we're going to focus mostly on this guy here. So I'm going to show you how can we design different low-pass filters that have this sort of structure. Okay, so let me stop and ask for a second if there are any questions about this. Okay, so let's get down to it. So let's actually design some filters, okay? So again, the big picture is we have a model for we have a desired amplitude response. And so from now on, I can really just focus on the amplitude response, right? Because by my choice of requiring the filter to be linear phase, I have removed that from the equation, because I know that the only kinds of filters I'm allowed to make are these nice symmetric guys like this, and the linear phase of this guy has already been determined by the length of the filter, right? So if I say I want a length 21 filter, I already know that the phase is going to be e to the minus j omega times 10, right? So I don't get any negotiation about what the linear phase is if I've already fixed the length of the filter. So the only thing I can decide is, what do I want the amplitude to look like? And so for a low-pass filter, we have basically a desired response that looks like this, right? And just to refresh on the terminology, right, so this is going to be what I call the passband. This is what I'm going to call the stopband. And this omega cutoff is basically the transition frequency, okay? And so, as we're going to talk about in just a second, you know, this is obviously the ideal thing that we want, right? But there are cases where I may be willing to compromise on this exact shape in order to get a nicer, which I'll talk about in a second, a nicer response. So for example, instead I may say something like this. I want to have, you know, the filter be for sure one in the passband, and for sure zero in the stopband. And in the middle, maybe I will let this kind of gracefully go down like this. And so this I would call the transition region. And so maybe I specify the transition region as being between, you know, omega 1 and omega 2. Or, instead of actually explicitly specifying what the filter does in that transition region, maybe I'll just say, okay, you know, I don't really care. You know, here's the passband. Here's the stopband. You know, I don't care how you get from the passband to the stopband as long as you get there, right? So here I'm basically allowing the filter to, calls it don't care. So basically I'm just allowing the filter to get from the passband to the stopband however it wants to, right? So maybe instead of my specifying a given shape in the transition region, instead the filter might be able to find a nicer way to get there that gives me better characteristics of the passband to the stopband, for example. Right? So we're going to talk about all three of these kinds of things going forward. Okay, so what are some of the criteria that we might use to decide, is this filter good or not? Okay, so approximation criteria. So one is, you know, the most obvious thing to do is to say something like, I want to look at the average or the squared error in the frequency domain. And that's what we're going to mostly talk about today, which is basically saying, okay, suppose I nail down some points in the frequency domain and I say, okay, I want you to get as close as possible to the values of the frequency response at this set of points, right? Hop to it. So that's what you would call basically a least squares approximation. Another possibility is to specify that you will not tolerate any more than a certain maximum error over the passband or the stopband. So that's like saying, okay, you know, if this is my desired filter, that's like saying, okay, I'm not going to let you go beyond some you know, error. Otherwise, I consider that to be unacceptable. And so that's a way of kind of saying, okay, I'm going to minimize what I would call the ripple of the filter. We're going to talk about that more on Thursday. And so this leads to what's called Chebyshev approximations. And the third thing is basically like a Taylor series approximation. To the desired response, which is also kind of sometimes called maximally flat. That means that, you know, I want the, you know, the function and all its derivatives to be as close to, you know, this as possible, right? So this leads to what are called Butterworth filters. I think you guys probably saw some Butterworth filters like in signals and systems, for example, right? So I may say, for example, I want the filter to be really flat in the passband, and I want to have a maximum ripple of something in the stopband, and then I find the best filter coefficients, right? So we're going to talk a little bit more about these two guys in the next lecture and focus on least squares stuff today. But, you know, the idea is that depending on what I use as my, you know, criteria, then I get different filters. Okay. And these guys have all sorts of advantages and disadvantages, right? These guys, least squares methods, are extremely simple to implement, but the filter may do things in between where I take my samples that I can't really do anything about. You know, these guys, you know, are better in terms of being able for me to control the ripple of the filter, but it may take a while for that design process to converge, and it's harder to do by hand or in MATLAB. I mean, MATLAB has a built-in function to do it, but otherwise you'd have to kind of write this iterative function to do it. And this, you know, this is nice because I can get basically analytic solutions for the filter. Like, there are people who studied filter design and found out, okay, what is the best set of filter coefficients if I care only about how flat things are, but not what's going on in the transition band. Okay, so let's talk about number one, frequency sampling. Okay, so frequency sampling design. So here's the setup. I take my filter, my desired response, and in all my cases, I'm always kind of using this low pass sharp cutoff as my canonical example, but you can really do this with any amplitude response that you want. It's just because we're so familiar with low-pass filters and why we care about them that I'm using it like this, okay? So what I would do is I'd say, here's my desired amplitude response. And what I'm going to do is I am going to, and actually I'm going to kind of draw this like from 0 to 2 pi, okay? Because I know this is 2 pi periodic. What I'm going to do is I'm going to sample this guy at a set of equally spaced values, like this. I'm going to sample n, where again, n equals the length of the filter. Equally spaced values of the desired amplitude response. And these omegas, if they're equally spaced, are just going to be 2 pi k over n, where k goes from 0 to n minus 1, right? So actually, I know, right, these filters, these samples are exactly the samples that I would have gotten if I had taken the DFT, right? So this is like an ideal DTFT. When I took the DFT, it's like sampling that guy at equally spaced points, right? And so if I wanted to know what is the, you know, what is the impulse response that corresponds to hitting exactly these samples, well, all I would do is take the inverse DFT. So we can get an FIR filter that exactly interpolates or goes through these samples. With the inverse DFT. That is, I get my filter by applying this formula. This is just the inverse DFT formula. Because the way I think about this is that I have, you know, n equations in the n unknowns of the filter, right? So I'm telling you, what is the frequency response at n points? You have to find me n filter taps. So there should be an exact solution to that problem, right? I should be able to find a filter that exactly goes through those points, okay? And again, here, my, you know, the nice thing is that because of my formula for the amplitude response that I had before, I can actually explicitly plug in. So for type 1 filter, I can explicitly plug in the amplitude values that I get and write them like a sum of a bunch of cosines. Right, so basically here, this is like A0, A1, and so on. So that's pretty sweet. That means that if I just tell you these amplitudes, that I can automatically generate these H's. And so let's actually see how this works in MATLAB, for example. So I'm going to do it a slightly different way in MATLAB, but it's equivalent. So, yeah. What was that? Okay. So let's suppose that I want to design a lane 15 filter. Okay, so here, let me just go back to this for a second. So let's do an example where I'd say n equals 15. That means that my m is going to be n minus 1 over 2, which equals 7. And let me suppose I want to design a filter with cutoff of 0.4 pi. Okay, so this is my goal. All right, so let's see how we can do that in MATLAB. And of course, this is exactly the kind of thing I'm going to have you do on the homework. So first, I need to make my amplitude vector, right? So what is my amplitude vector going to be? Well, I'm going to need to make a set of omegas that is basically 2 pi over 15 times this. So these are my samples of my frequency axis, okay? And I also need to know what is the desired amplitude response to each of those samples. So first I have to compute what is 0.4 times pi. So 0.4 times pi is 1.2566, and I can see that actually that corresponds to this sample over here. So that's like saying that my desired amplitude response has got to be the first four samples should be at 1, and then the ones that are in the stop band should be at 0, and then again, because this wraps around 2 pi, I have to go back up to 1 again. And so what I would do would be to say my amplitude is basically the places where omega is less than or equal to my cutoff, or places where my omega is greater than 2 pi minus my cutoff, right? So here, this is like saying, okay, I want the first four entries to be 1, then I drop down to 0 for a while, then I go back up to 1, okay? And just as a sanity check, you know, your A should always be kind of symmetric around. So here, the way I think about this is that this here is the DC element. That's like the zero element, right? So I need to have, you know, that guy is unique, and then I have, you know, some entries over here that should mirror the entries over here. And the reason there aren't four ones on the right-hand side is because I stop before I get to 2 pi, right? I stop just short of 2 pi by one sample. And now I'd figure out, what is my desired phase got to be? Well, my phase is going to be minus m times omega, right? So I know that this is my phase vector. And then I compute my desired h as the amplitude times the phase. I guess I need a dot here. Okay. And so now I should be able to just take the inverse DFT of this thing to get inverse FFT, sorry. I forgot that MATLAB doesn't know about the DFT. So when I do this, I get something that has some both real and complex parts. You can see all the complex parts are zero. This is just a kind of a round-off thing. So it's always best to make this guy explicitly real. And now, if I were to do a stem plot of the filter that I designed, I can see that I screwed it up somehow. How did I screw it up? That was pretty good. Let's just look at this again for a second. I feel like I'm one entry off here for some reason, because it should be symmetric around the middle guy. So what did I do wrong? Got my A, I got my phase, which was 7. Oh, I did the wrong phase. The phase is this, and then I have the E of the minus J omega here. That was my mistake. Okay, much better, right? So here I can see that I get a filter that has exactly the property that I said it would, right? It's symmetric around the middle element, and I can see that just one quirk of the MATLAB indexing is that you can't get a zero element in MATLAB, right? So everything is kind of shifted. So you can see this is symmetric around the eighth element, whereas really, if I was applying this in a digital world, this would be shifted over so it was symmetric around the seventh element, okay? And now I can look at the, I should be able to look at the impulse response, or sorry, the frequency response that corresponds to this. So let me say that my H designed is, so now what I want to do is I want to take a finer set of omegas to plot the frequency response out. So I'm going to say, what is the set of omegas I care about for plotting? And I'm just going to make a length 151 vector. And then I'm going to evaluate my frequency response at these elements. And now I'm going to look at the frequency response I get, only looking at the absolute value of it. So here, I see that my frequency response looks kind of wiggly, but does have the characteristic of a low-pass filter. And if I were to plot back out the original values that I specified, I should see that the values that I asked for exactly lie on the frequency response, right? So this is exactly what makes sense, right? I've made something that fits exactly the values I asked about, and in between the values, it does as good a job as possible of, you know, oscillating between, right? Okay. So let me stop and ask if there are any questions about this example. You're going to be doing exactly the same thing on the homework, so it's good to really understand what's happening here. Okay. So the next question to ask is, well, can't I control what's happening in between the samples, right? So, I mean, what I really want is to force the frequency response to exactly match up with that desired shape all the way along the frequency response, right? And so it turns out that you can do that. So let's talk about how that would work. Okay. And so before I move off of just that, let me just say that they're basically equivalent formulas for type 2, 3, and 4 filters, which I'm not going to talk about. Or when we take the samples differently spaced. And so what I mean by that is that, you know, maybe instead of, suppose this is my desired frequency response, and maybe what I might want to do is to take these equally spaced samples in such a way that, you know, one sample is like pretty close to the passband edge and the other sample is at the other side of the passband edge. So what I'm trying to do is I'm trying to force the frequency response to kind of get as steep of a response as possible, kind of by screwing around with where these samples are. Okay. And you can also use basically, you know, n non-uniformly spaced samples. But then I can't use the inverse DFT, which is okay. Basically, you know, the inverse DFT is a ready-made solution to the question about if I have equally spaced samples in the frequency domain, what do they correspond to in the time domain, right? If I don't space the samples equally, I still have n equations and unknowns, but those equations are defined by this matrix of cosines I'm going to talk about in just a second. Okay. So instead, what I want to do is, let's say, okay, you know, instead, what about minimizing the error at, you know, L greater than N samples, right? So there, that's like saying, okay, you know, suppose I still want to design a length N filter, but instead I make a whole bunch of samples over here and say, well, you've got to do as well as possible at all these samples, okay? Now, if the number of samples I tell you is a lot bigger than the number of filter coefficients I have, then clearly I can't satisfy all those equations at once, because each one of those dots corresponds to one equation in N unknowns, right? If I have more equations than unknowns, then I'm stuck with what's called a least squares solution, where instead of getting exactly interpolating through these dots, I end up with an approximate solution. I kind of minimize the sum of squared errors at those dots, okay? And so here, the error function that I have looks something like this, where I look at all of my L dots and I want to minimize the difference between my amplitude that I get and the amplitude that I want, where these omega k's are basically 2 pi k over L. Okay. Well, this solution actually turns out to be very easy. And the reason that it works this way is because this sum of squared errors turns out to have a corresponding interpretation in the time domain, right? So you guys maybe remember distantly when we were talking about frequency domain properties, there was this theorem called Parseval's theorem that said that, you know, basically the sum of squares in the frequency domain is the same as the sum of squares in the time domain. And so it turns out this error by Parseval's theorem can be written in this way. And here I'm kind of centering the filter um,
this. So here it's like saying where HD of M is the length L FIR filter, that goes through the L desired samples, which I can get from the previous method. And then to minimize, what I should do is I should choose my H of N to agree with my H desired of N on the middle N filter taps. This is like truncating H desired event. So what I mean by that is basically the following. So I would say, okay, I could design my, you know, great length L filter that, again, by symmetry has to look something like this. Right, this filter would be the one that would minimize the error, or that would actually exactly interpolate those L points. But then if I say, okay, I want to find a length 5 filter that tries to minimize my error on those L points, all I would do is I would notch out the middle 5 units of these guys, and this would become my new best filter. Right? So it's actually very easy to design these least squares filters by saying, okay, first I find the best long filter, and then I just chop out the middle n pieces that I need. Okay. So basically just chop out the middle n taps from the long filter. Okay, so let's do that in MATLAB, in hopefully a way that I don't screw it up. So let's suppose that, going back to my picture, suppose I wanted to actually minimize the sum of the squared error between the filter that I design at each of these 151 points. Okay, so what I should be able to do is I should be able to define my length 151 filter using the same method I used before. So here I have my omega fine, and my h fine is going to be basically, so now I need to define a finer amplitude. So just like I defined a like this, I'm going to define something like this, a fine. So here is my finer set of amplitude samples. I'm going to define a finer set of phis. And again, I have to figure out what is the corresponding phase for that. Well, it's going to be 151 minus 1 over 2, right? So that's going to be 75. And now I'm going to generate my fine frequency response, which is going to be this, which I guess I kind of can say like this. Oh, yes, you're right. Okay, and now my H fine should be the real part of the inverse FFT of H fine. And let me just look at that for a second. Steam, me and steam. Right, so here, this is like a length 151 filter that, again, nicely symmetric around the middle, right? And so what I would do if I wanted to get the middle part, I would say, okay, I'm going to take the middle part is going to be the middle element of this guy is 76, and I'm going to take this 15 elements plus or minus 7 on either side, right? And so if I look at my truncated filter, that's just going to be these middle elements. And if I compare that to the filter that I designed earlier, which I think I can do, I can see that those filter taps are not exactly the same, right? I mean, I get two symmetric filters, but the red filter, which is the one I designed before, is definitely not the same as the blue filter, okay? And by the same token, if I go back to my frequency response, right? So here is my original guy. Now I should be able to compute my h-fine, which actually I already have h-fine because I know it has to go through that. So I should just be able to say plot omega fine a-fine with a red line. Whoops. Oh, no, that's the fine guy. So, yeah, I know that's what I want. So what I should be able to do is I should be able to plot my H truncated should be what I get if I take my truncated filter I just designed and I apply it to the fine frequencies. And now I should be able to plot my absolute value of this. Let's plot that with a green line. Right, so here, I can kind of see that I have definitely a different filter than I got before. It still looks like a low-pass filter, but I can see it's definitely a lot different, especially in the stopband, right? So whereas the blue filter did a lot of oscillation, a little bouncing in the stopband before, now I'm kind of telling the filter, okay, you have to be as good as possible at every equally spaced point along the 0 to pi range. And that forces the green filter to push down and minimize these ripples, right? So I can see that my error is a lot smaller. And if I wanted to, I could compute the error, but you can kind of see visually why that error has to be much better, right? Okay. So let me pause and ask. So questions about this? Okay. So let me go back to my paper for a second. So one thing that I wanted to say is that, you know, when you have non-equally spaced samples, it's easier to think about how to design your filter with a matrix, with a matrix equation. And so here is my equation that I had before for my amplitude as a function of the taps. And what I can think about that is basically saying that's like I have a vector of desired amplitude responses that multiplies a set of filter taps. And actually, you can see here that I really only need to have m plus 1 filter taps, because the thing is symmetric around the middle, right? So I only have to compute the first half of the filter coefficients because I can just mirror them across the middle element to get the rest. And so here, this is like saying I have maybe L positions I care about. So this is like an L by 1 vector. This is an L by m plus 1 matrix full of cosines. And I can kind of write this like, you know, F times H equals my amplitude desired. And then I could use MATLAB to basically find the best H's given the A's, right? So if F is square, then the H's are just F inverse times A. Otherwise, the least squares solution is given by this guy here, which is called the Sioux inverse. But in both cases, you can do this in MATLAB just with F backslash AD, right? And so this is what you should always be doing anyway, because you should never be computing the inverse directly when you solve linear algebra problems. You should always be, you know, computing like backslash, which is basically a fancy way of doing Gaussian elimination and all that stuff that you learned back in IEA, maybe, or something. Okay, and so you can also directly design filters like this. And an important place where I care about not having the samples equally spaced is something like I talked about earlier, where I could say, okay, I am going to take, you know, my passband and my stopband. Here is my response. So I could say, okay, here are a bunch of places where I want to minimize the error. And in this region here, this would be like a kind of a don't care transition band. Right? What that means is that the filter is going to be able to achieve better approximation at these points because I'm not telling anything about what happens in the middle. Right? So you'll usually find that if you don't specify these middle points, you'll get pretty good adherence to the points of the passband and the stopband. And then there'll be some sort of like graceful fall off that goes in the transition band. And of course, you know, the wider I make this transition band, the more freedom the filter has to do stuff in the middle, right? And so I think that I have an example of this in the homework. So you can try putting a bunch of samples of the stop band, a bunch of samples of the pass band, and don't care in the middle, and see if you can make that filter do better in the pass band and the stop band. And even more so, you could put kind of weight. You could put different weights on the points to say, I really care about getting close. Maybe you care more about getting closer in the passband than you do in the stopband, right? And so in that case, you have a different function that's something like you have a sum of weighted values where I care about different points with different weights. And then my design filter is related to my other filter by something that includes this diagonal weight matrix. So all I'm saying here is that you can treat each one of these sample points differently if you wanted to. And you could force better approximation of the pass band than the stop band, for example. Okay, so the last thing I'm going to say is that one other thing I'm going to have you do in the homework is, you know, you can also try to manually design a transition band. So, for example, you could manually put a line here, or you could manually put like a quadratic here, or maybe you could use like a cubic spline interpolation, right? So, you know, you can kind of work to do that. I think there's one thing on the homework where I say, okay, let's imagine there's a line that connects the passband and the stopband, and then some of these samples are going to occur on the line, right? And you can see how that affects things. Okay, so I think that's a good place for me to stop. Let me just pause and ask if any questions about this. So like I said, I believe that you should be able to fully do